Hello and welcome to Tar Heel Teachers at Home. I'm Marlow Artis. I'm the moderator of the program. Tar Heel Teachers at Home is an interview series focused on engaging North Carolinians in conversations around education. Each week, I'm happily joined by a wonderful panel of educators, each one representing a particular subsection of education. We'll start our introductions with our elementary school panelists.
Hi, my name is Amy Tart, and I teach fourth grade ELA and social studies for Clinton City Schools. You can find me on Twitter at Cards for Scholars.
Hello, my name is Demetria Smith. I am the principal of Brogdon Middle School in Wayne County, Goldsboro, North Carolina, and I am the current and 2021-2022 Wayne County Public Schools Principal of the Year. You can find me on Twitter at DASmith1908.
Congratulations. Thank you so much for joining us, Dr. Smith.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Brian Link, and I'm a social studies teacher at East Chapel Hill High School, where I'm also the director of its Social Justice Academy. I'm the 2021 Chapel Hill-Carrboro Teacher of the Year. It's a pleasure to be with you this evening.
We're so glad to have you as well, Brian. Congratulations to you as well.
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Arisha Smalls. I'm the Elementary AIG Program Specialist for Cumberland County Schools, and you can follow me on Twitter at SmallsArisha.
Wonderful. For this episode of Tar Heel Teachers at Home, we are chatting with Dr. Chip Buckwell, who is the superintendent of Kannapolis City Schools. After serving North Carolina Public Schools for 37 years, 36 in Kannapolis City Schools, Dr. Buckwell is concluding his tenure. He is here to share some of his career highlights. Dr. Buckwell, thank you so much for joining us here on Tar Heel Teachers at Home.
Glad to join you. And my Twitter is Chip Buckwell on Twitter. So follow and I follow back.
Sounds great. We are so glad to have you here. So Dr. Buckwell, let's start with Kannapolis City Schools. How would you describe your school system to individuals who haven't had an opportunity to visit your district?
I would say it's very dynamic. It is very diverse. We are a little over a third Hispanic, a little under a third white, and about 29% African-American. And so we're very diverse, and that's very unusual for our area of the state to be that diverse. We are excited about the opportunities we're providing kids in Kannapolis, and especially leading to real meaningful jobs or college careers after high school. It's a blessing that we've been able to accomplish some of the things we have with our kids.
Awesome. And you've been the superintendent since 2016 for the last 5 years. So Dr. Buckwell, give us an overview of your career. Tell us about your time as a classroom teacher and tell us about that transition into administration.
So I started out in Kinston City Schools back in 1983. I was an athletic trainer and a physical education teacher at Kinston Junior High School. I left there and went to Kannapolis City Schools, the A.L. Brown High School, as an in-school suspension teacher and athletic trainer. From there, I went to JTPA, which is the old Job Training Partnership Act, which is career development today. I went from there to dropout prevention to student services at the central office. From student services, we added testing and accountability. From testing and accountability and student services, I went to the principalship at a little elementary school that is now called North Kannapolis Elementary. It was Woodrow Wilson, and we just recently changed the name. Mm-hmm. And from there, I went to the middle school and stayed there 12 and a half years. I was pretty much an albatross at the middle school. You know, nobody gets to stay anywhere 12 and a half years anymore. And I came to the central office as assistant superintendent in 13. And then the superintendency in January of 16. And that's pretty much it in the capsule.
A lot of different roles and a lot of opportunities to serve over the course of your 36 years in Kannapolis City Schools and your 37 years total. Dr. Buckwell was named the 2019-2020 Southwest Region Superintendent of the Year. So he's had a very celebrated career, and we're very fortunate to have him here on Tar Heel Teachers at Home. What questions do we have for Dr. Buckwell?
I thought that I would ease Dr. Buckwell into with the easy question. Have you ever driven a bus for the school system? Because it seems like that's the only thing missing from your resume.
Okay. So I never formally drove a bus for the school system. At the middle school, you know, is the keys are left in the buses sometimes, and I had to move a bus, and getting the brakes to work was the most challenging part of that whole deal. So no, ma'am, I've not formally driven a bus, but I moved one time.
Okay. And so my real question is, when I was reading up on your career history and saw that you had worked with dropout intervention, I was just curious to know, have any of the key contributors to dropout changed? Have you seen any change from 30 years ago to now?
Well, yes, I've seen a good bit of change. I think the biggest change is the connection between the community and business and industry to the high schools now. And the business and industry now are saying, you have to have these credentials to be able to work here. You have to have these credentials to be able to progress in our business. And so we got kids that are getting credentials that can leave high school ready to work. And literally, when I came to Kannapolis, and Kannapolis is known for its textile mills back in the day. And when I came to Kannapolis, there was a loom in one of the classrooms that we were literally training kids to use. And a lot of those kids left school and went to work straight in the mill because it was a good job. It was a steady job and it was well paying, contrary to what a lot of people think from back in the day. So we were literally losing almost 300 kids a year to drop out when I came to Kannapolis City Schools. And it's just startling. I mean, it was just but they could go to work. You know, if they had a family to help support or to support themselves, they were able to get a job. They could literally walk two blocks to plant one and fill out an application and go to work.
Thank you for sharing that.
Yes, ma'am.
I had a question for your wealth of knowledge over your career. I'm just trying to make it past year 7. So I was asked this the other day and I thought it was a really loaded question, but it really had me thinking. So I wanted to ask you, what do you think is the number one factor for student success? Out of every single factor there could be, what do you think is the most single important factor in student success?
Everybody has to belong to somebody. And that interpersonal relationship with other people, it can be with another student, it can be with a staff member, it can be with a staff member that they had when they were a kindergarten student. But everybody needs and has to belong to somebody to be successful at the end of the day. And those kids who are sometimes the toughest to reach, and I'm sure Dr. Smith knows about that in middle school, because it was a hard time. You do everything you can to create that relationship. Anytime you can create a relationship with a kid, you got a chance to win. If you don't create that relationship, you got no shot at winning. It doesn't matter how smart you are, what you got to offer them. If you don't have a relationship with them, you're not going to win in the end of the day. Excuse me, they're not going to win at the end of the day, because it's their progress and their work that we've got to make sure is successful.
Love that. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
That was very well said. Relationships are imperative to our job as educators. And along that same line, in the article that was written on you in the Salisbury Post, it said that you were an ambassador for public education. That's a huge role. How would you encourage other educators to be ambassadors for public education as we move forward in times such as this?
Well, I think you got to, in some regards, what folks would call getting dirty. You have to do the little jobs that nobody else wants to do or can do. My buildings that I was in charge of were always amongst the cleanest places that there were, because I think kids respect that cleanliness and they then expect the cleanliness. And then it's easy for them to come to school and respect the building and the people and the job that they've got to do inside the building. So it's doing the little things that nobody else wants to do. I think it's, you know, in my old age, it's been harder for me to hold my tongue lately with our politicians and other folks. But I think you find a way, and especially you guys on this screen, find a way to engage our politicians and correct people, not in a confrontational way, but correct people when they're wrong about kids and public education. Mm-hmm. Because the misinformation out there is astounding. It's ridiculous. Years ago, I can't think of who it was, and I packed that book up today, but there was a book called The Manufactured Crisis, and it talked about the SAT and how, you know, if it was normed on white males in the 50s. So if the fact that we have diversified the people that have taken the SAT over the years, the fact that the SAT scores have remained basically very similar, and with all the immigration and non-English speaking students that we've gained, the fact that the SAT scores haven't plummeted is a testament to how good public education is, not a testament that how bad we fail, but there is how you look at those things. And I think you just gotta, I know you have to look at things and help people understand what really goes on in classrooms and what really goes on in families. And in our case, in Kannapolis, you know, in our mayor calls it the legacy area of Kannapolis, because in Kannapolis City Schools, we are the only district in the state that lies in two counties. So we don't have, the city limits doesn't reflect the city school system lines. So we are inside of the city limits line. So we're like the donut hole in a donut. That's us. And we're, you know, it's the poverty in our area. When the mill closed, you know, there were folks that came in because the housing was so cheap, but they didn't have the skills and they didn't have the background that they needed to be able to go into the jobs that we had at that point in time. And so those folks who were skilled laborers, they left with where the jobs were going. And so we're just now we're just now filling those gaps, and you know, our kids are being really successful with finding jobs or going on to two-year, four-year colleges and universities. You know, we do well with kids today, but I think it's you've got to be able to talk to people and let them know how what they hear about public education isn't what's going on in public education.
Well, I'd like to jump in there, speaking about perhaps people not hearing the full story in relationships. One of the things I was struck in learning about you and efforts that you established in your district was the mentor program. As a mentor myself, and we're looking to get more educators into the classroom, I was wondering if you could talk a little more about, you know, how you were able to develop the relationship with the university to get folks in and to have a lot more classroom teaching time at the elementary school levels. And I was wondering if you have any sort of long-term success follow-up and whether or not that's something that can be scaled up to the middle and high schools as well.
So I know this is going to sound interesting, but I just don't say no. You find a way to make things happen. You know, the university system hasn't always done a great job in preparing students to come out of college into the classroom to be teachers. And so if it's not happening, how do we make a difference in that? Well, we invite them into the school earlier and we create programs and opportunities where they're getting classroom experience as sophomores in high school. So I did a lot of recruiting teachers in my time. And when I went to Ohio, I was hiring teachers with 1,000 hours worth of experience, and they were A1s or whatever, beginning teachers. So, or A0s, I should say. So they, you know, they were brand new teachers right out of college, but they had 1,000 hours of experience. So I'm sitting there going, how can we have 1,000 hours of experience? And talk to the folks at UNC Charlotte. There was a couple of them that wrote a grant. They said, are you interested? And I said, absolutely, let's go. And, it just won a national award this past spring for its mentor program. And it's just in my world, I was an old coach. So at the end of the day, you can't, especially in high school, you can recruit in college and those kind of things. But in high school and in middle school, you took the kids who were in front of you and you tried to make them better. That's absolutely 100% all we're trying to do with that is take the, and they're not kids, they're grown adults, but take the kids that are in front of us that are in college and make them better prepared. So we had 36 over the last 2 years, and I think we hired like 24 of the 36 people that came out of the program. Now, the ones who we didn't hire, it wasn't because they weren't capable, it was because they went home. You know, they went back to Hickory, they went back to Lenoir, they went back to Greenville, North Carolina, they went wherever they grew up. And it wasn't that we wouldn't have hired them, because if we'd had positions, we'd have hired them. But we've made good work of the program, and we've had kids that are just, I mean, those students from UNC Charlotte have been fantastic. And we're also trying to build similar programs with our HBCUs, because we know that they're underrepresented in our district, and it's just, you know, we're partnering with A&T right now to try to make sure that we get some principal with their principal fellows program that they're trying to establish right now, to make sure that we're getting leadership out of A&T and other universities. I think we got all the tools we need in North Carolina to make this work. What we don't have is people working together to always make it work. I have every confidence in every school, every university we have in North Carolina, and the kids that we're sending to those universities to make this work. We got to get together on it.
Thanks for sharing. Appreciate it.
No problem.
I applaud you as an alumnus of Winston-Salem State University's education program and an HBCU grad. Thank you for thinking of that and putting forth those efforts. And along that same line, what advice would you offer to aspiring leaders?
Reasonableness and common sense. So throughout COVID, in order to make things work on all the Zoom meetings we had, I would come up with these I call them hash browns, because I know it's not cool. You know, if I sounded uncool, it would work. So I come up with all these hash browns: education is an investment. So what I would tell new leaders is, you can have all the book knowledge you can stand. You can listen to every TED talk. You can do all of the preparation that you can possibly get, and study and read everything. If you don't use reasonableness and common sense, you are not going to be as successful as you could be. And people talk about common sense not being common anymore. I think common sense is really common. What I think it is we create policy, and we create rules, and we create laws that inhibit me, or try to inhibit me, from using reasonableness and common sense in the application of everyday skills and things that need to go on with kids. You know, we micromanage what's in the curriculum. We micromanage the policy. We micromanage the school year. We micromanage everything we can micromanage. But then when we want accountability, we tell people, well, then you got to do this. You got to take a 3-hour test 3 days in a row if you're in fifth grade, and you got to sit there and make sure you do that. So my rule would be, if you're going to run for the state legislature, you need to pass the reading, math, and science EOG in eighth grade before you're allowed to run. Because if you can do that, if you can do what our eighth graders are asked to do, if somebody goes in there and actually, you know, performs that, then I've got a lot more respect for you, because I got a lot of respect for eighth graders. You sit through 9 hours of testing in a 3-day period, I got even more respect for third graders who can pull it off. But, you know, you know eighth graders, Dr. Smith, you know how they are. So yeah. I think if we had some more reasonableness and common sense practicing after all the knowledge that we gain, I think we'd be a lot better off.
I was looking around trying to find my hash brown. I had a little sign. I had a little sign that I would hold up during my team meetings that said, "Everything is figure outable." So that was my little piece of encouragement for everybody.
I'm writing that one down.
Everything is figure outable. I wanted to talk to you. I know you're on your way out. But I want to talk to you about the branding of your district, because I think that you have done a fantastic job with branding. And on YouTube I saw that you have, I want to get it right, is KCS Weekly Updates, where you are like the face of your district, because you are, but you're the one that is giving the messages directly to all of your stakeholders. It's not coming from another person's automated voice system. It's you doing that. And I just think that's awesome. What do you think? What do you think some of the biggest challenges were when you came in to your superintendency when it comes to rebranding or making it your own?
So I think what happens a lot of times is we want to live up to somebody else's expectations, and the of people who want to brand you in what they think you are. And so I think you've got to really, really, really figure out, who am I, not just am I personally, but who am I as a school district? What are we, what do we stand for? And tonight in our board meeting, I used this one because our high school mascots wonders. And so I started using this. This sign is all over the place. After 2 weeks ago, it's now in the congressional record because our representative spoke on the floor of the House and put it in there. So you've got to believe that wonders never cease. Whatever it is that would apply to you guys, you've got to believe that, and you got to be the face of that. I started doing the video updates because of COVID. So people had dashboards. I didn't want a dashboard. Everybody had a dashboard. People, reported it to the newspaper. Okay, well, if the newspaper wants to listen to my video, they can get the information, or everybody can get it. Plus, there's the word trust comes in here, and it is really, really important. And I think over my 36 years here in Kannapolis, I've built up a lot of trust. If I say something is going to happen, then it generally speaking is going to happen. If I tell you that your child messed up, generally speaking, your child messed up, and people have gone to trust me. And so when COVID came, it was like, well, I've got to stand up here and say, this is what we're doing, and this is how it's going to happen. So in my case, I read, I gave the board a recommendation about what to do. I didn't let the board give me a recommendation, because I'm sitting in the Zoom meetings. I'm sitting in there with epidemiologists from Duke University. I'm doing all of those things, and it can go back to 2016 or when I got the job, or 2006 or 96 or whenever. I tried to be as the most informed person about that issue that there is in our district. And so whether it was middle school, whether it was elementary school reading or whatever it was, I wanted to be the most informed, because if you can't speak from a perspective of confidence and be courageous about that, I don't know what else. I don't know how to act if you're not willing to do that. And if you speak from a point of truth and you speak from a point of knowledge, then you're more trustworthy for most people. There's going to be people who look at you. I got a guy who lives around the block from me, and he questions everything that goes on in public education and in Kannapolis City Schools. And it takes me about 45 seconds of point to go Google it and prove him wrong. So now he's gotten to where he takes some of his stuff back down that he puts up. So, it's just building that trust. You got to do it. And if you're going to be in a school district for a while, and I know people move a lot more now than they did, and I probably would too if I were beginning out there now. But the more trust you can build, the better off you're going to be, and the better off your kids are going to be, because they learn too. They see it too.
Well, if I can hop in here, speaking of education as an investment, right, and being courageous and building trust, we've seen that equity is certainly a hot topic these days in North Carolina. And I was hoping you could talk about your efforts, right, to promote equity within the district, right, to diversify the curriculum, to bring in the Racial Equity Institute. And I was hoping you could also say, right, you can read the headlines, but how has it been received by your students and parents and staff? And what are some of the long-term benefits and successes that you've seen as a result of the work that you've been able to accomplish?
So obviously we just went through a superintendent search, and the folks doing the search came in and says, asked me, he said, what are some things, what are two or three, four things that the next superintendent just has to know? And I said, there's only one. And that was equity. You've got to keep the equity focus that we have. We've had more than half of our staff, our certified staff, go through Racial Equity Institute training.
That's impressive. Now that right there is impressive. I had to just start right there. I don't know any other district that's had like half of your staff to go through REI. That is very impressive, Dr. Buckwell.
When I went through it, I'm going to tell you, and I was 3.5 years ago, so I was 59, I guess, at the time. It changed my life. It changed my career. I thought I knew some things. I didn't have a clue. I'll be straight up with you. I didn't have a clue. And just recently, what gets me is like one of the questions I asked my neighbor who wants to post things. I said, did you know about Black Wall Street? Because I didn't. They didn't teach me about that. They didn't teach me about Tulsa mm-hmm. in high school. Didn't teach me about it in middle school. Didn't teach me about it anywhere. I think that it's so important that kids see themselves in their work, see themselves in the curriculum. One of the best things we've done is work with Dr. Glass out of UNC Charlotte with text equity. So we have reviewed the curriculum we have to make sure that our students of color can see themselves in the literature, can see themselves in the work that they do. And, you know, it's not going to make what it's not one of those things that you check that box and okay, it's over. It's a continuous, you got to make the progress process work. I make mistakes. I say the wrong thing. I use the wrong terminology. I do things. I mean, I've been doing this a long time, so I make mistakes. But working to make sure that your kids can see themselves and see themselves in the curriculum that you're trying to teach is just, it's incredibly important. And we did as a nation, such a poor job of that. You all already know this. I mean, Texas, Florida, and California rule the textbook world. Well, I didn't know what I was doing in 1998, 99, when I was at North Kannapolis Elementary School, but I told them they weren't going to have another anthology because it was the same dang stories in the next anthology as the one previous to that. And we had six in the doggone storage room. So I said, you can buy book sets, you can buy anything you want to buy, but you're not buying another anthology to give the kids. And, we did, in middle school, when I walked down to the AIG classroom, it was all white. Man, white kids everywhere. Had a couple brown kids in there, but I mean, it was all white. So what we did was we took we placed everybody who was supposed to be placed in AIG in those AIG classes in an algebra. And then what we did is I just took the next highest performing group of black kids and made them AIG. They weren't they weren't certified AIG. They talked to their families, hey, we're putting them in algebra one. Are you sure you want to do that? Yeah. So we had some people that were anxious about it, but when we started out, we had about 75 kids in AIG and math. When algebra one became math one, we had 119 kids taking algebra one in a 400 student eighth grade class, and 117 of them passed the algebra one test. You put it in front of kids and you expect them to do well, and kids outperform what they think they can. I'm ashamed in some regard that I didn't know what I know today 25 years ago. But I'm glad I know it today, and I'm glad other people in this district know it now. And I think it's a movement that can't stop. You can call it whatever you want to call it. I don't care what you call it, but when you put in people's minds and their thoughts that, okay, I've got to change the way I look at my kids and the way I look at my curriculum and the way I teach people, then you're going to win a lot of battles like that.
Powerful words. Well, when it, sorry.
I was just going to say, well, you may not have known what you were doing back then, but I'm sure you know now that you were clustering your AIG kids. And that is something that we do across the state. So I do applaud you on that.
Well, you know, sometimes you make a mistake and it actually turns out not a mistake, but you do the right thing, but you didn't know you were doing the right thing at that time. It looked good for kids. It was, you know, in my world, it was, so why is this kid who's performing at a level 4, and that's what we had at the time in math, who's outperforming half of the AIG kids I got that are certified, how come he or she's not in an Algebra 1 class? That was just a simple question for me. I didn't know. So I was just dumb enough to put them in there, and they were smart enough to pass the test.
In addition to REI, Dr. Buckwell, can you also talk about the RKM Equity Summit? Because you also have partnered with other districts, Rowan Salisbury Schools and the Mooresville Graded School District, on different equity work. Can you tell us about that?
Yes, sir. So last year, it was in the middle of COVID, and we couldn't meet face-to-face, so we had to do it virtually. I thought it was a winning opportunity. Anytime we can share the work we do, no matter how small or how large it is, to try to make our schools more equitable so kids can see themselves and can do the work and know they can do the work, the better off we're all going to be. We leave trillions of dollars on the table because of equity, because we're not an equitable society in all regards. And if we were more equitable, and I'm hopeful, you know, I'm 62, I'm probably not going to live to see what I hope to see, because I hope it happens in the next 3 or 4 years. But on the other side, I can't do it for those reasons. I got to do it because it's the right thing to do. And you know, when people get mistaken about what they want to call things like critical race theory and all that stuff, you know, and they want to use it to keep the status quo, you know, you just can't do it. And I know, look, I know I'm a white guy. I get it. But I also know that I'm a person. And I also know that this counts and leadership matters. And it doesn't matter whatever we are, we've got to do the right thing by kids. And I wasn't doing the right thing throughout my career because I didn't know. Now that I know, you got to practice the common sense now. I got to do it. You just got to do it. And I know I'm retiring, but I was listening to some podcast today on the way to work, and it's inspiring me to do something. I don't know what it is yet. And people keep asking me, what are you going to do after retirement? And I don't know. I don't have a clue. And I don't know. I don't have a plan. We got to have a plan. Well, maybe it's something like that. I don't know. Maybe I can help, you know, people in our community who look like me understand better, because I don't know, you know, I don't know who they listen to, but maybe I can help them. I'm hopeful.
Awesome. Wow, we're very hopeful too. So glad that you were able to join us for this conversation, Dr. Volker. Are there any other pressing questions? Because this leader is a wealth of knowledge, and I want to make sure we don't leave any questions on the floor.
So if you had one dream for what North Carolina education was going to look like in the next 5 years, what is your one dream for it?
Wow, that's tall there, Amy. I think that the one dream has to center around equity. I think we've got to make schools across the board more engaging and give kids the opportunity to leave school, every kid with the opportunity to leave school with a credential or a plan to go to a 2-year school or a plan to go to a 4-year school, and the credential leads to a job placement. I was asked the other day, my point about legacy is, it's, if I have a legacy, it's about people. It's not about stuff, you know, stuff, whatever that is. But we have a pre-apprenticeship program that has placed all 42 kids in jobs, all 42. And when you look those kids and those families in the eyes, and you know that kid's going out there and they're not working for minimum wage, they're working for, you know, well over minimum wage. Some of them have bought the first piece of property their family has ever owned. You know, when you're making that difference with kids, they can take all the Superintendent of the Year awards or whatever. And I don't care. It doesn't make any difference. It doesn't even matter. So just take all the stuff and do whatever you're going to do with it. But when it gets down to the kids, let's just help them all be more successful, regardless of what they look like, where they come from, who they belong to, the whole nine yards. Just help them all be more successful.
That's wonderful. Well, Dr. Buckwell, we thank you so much for coming on our program and sharing your journey. Our public schools are better off because you have served, and we thank you so much for your service. We really do.
Thank you very much.
We'd like to thank our audience so very much for watching our program. We hope that you will engage us on our social media. Please follow us on Twitter. Our handle is @TarHillTeachers. Please like our Facebook page. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel. Visit our website, tarhillteachers.com. And on all of our social media platforms, please use our hashtag, TarHillTeachers, so that we can find all of your great comments. I'd like to thank our wonderful group of panelists for joining us for this conversation, Amy Tart, Dr. Demetia Smith, Brian Link, and Arisha Smalls. And once again, we would like to thank our special guest, Dr. Chip Buckwell. He is the retiring superintendent of Kannapolis City Schools. He's been with the district for 36 years. We look forward to seeing you next time on Tar Heel Teachers at Home.